Long before Wade Wilson, Deadpool paused in scene to talk to his audience and readers, other characters did that very thing, a thing called fourth wall breaking. One of the first, in fact, is a character that's been around for a long time in Marvel lore. I'm talking about attorney Jennifer Walters, aka She-Hulk. With a Disney Plus show starring She-Hulk announced at 2019's D23, it's a perfect time to dive into her history. Before we begin, I want to thank you for watching JLS Comics. Whether you're coming back or it's your first time here, thank you. Don't forget to subscribe. We upload videos just like this every single week. So let's jump into our She-Hulk story. There are two things that Marvel Comics have perpetuated over the last few decades, and really comic books since their inception, and that is of the spin-off character, and more specifically, distaff counterparts. There's been Green Hulk, Red Hulk, Gray Hulk, Immortal Hulk, 2099 Hulk, Orange Hulk, Maestro, Old Man Logan's Hillbilly Hulk family, Ultimate Hulk, Professor Hulk, and that brings us to Hulk and his cousin She-Hulk. In 1977, the Incredible Hulk TV show aired on CBS, and this was during an explosion of licensed properties being sold to film and TV and animation studios at the time. Spider-Man, Doctor Strange, Fantastic Four, The Elektra Company, Shazam, Captain America, Spider-Woman, Wonder Woman, they all made their way across mediums. Others were planned as well, like Daredevil and Black Widow and Avengers, and Marvel could sell the rights to their own IP, and they did it with a great amount of success. These were extremely popular, the females here were extremely popular, and there was another one named Bionic Woman, who was one of the most popular of them all. If one of these shows, though, created a character for the show, they'd own the rights to that character. So with the success of Hulk and the popularity of Bionic Woman, Stan Lee was afraid that CBS was going to create a female counterpart for the Hulk for the show. So Stan Lee set out to make one more character before he stepped away from creating full-time, and that character was She-Hulk. To really solidify their IP ownership, a new comic book series was created called Savage She-Hulk that was launched at the beginning of 1980. She-Hulk was created, of course, by the legendary Stan Lee, but the also legendary John Buscema. In her debut issue, Hulk's comic book and TV series references the very first thing, and we also learn in this first splash page that Jennifer, or Jen, is Banner's cousin. Jen grew up in the Los Angeles area, her dad a sheriff, and her mom killed when she was young. As she grew up, Jen graduated from UCLA's School of Law and found herself working at a law firm. When Banner finally meets up with her after all those years in that debut issue, she's deep in a case defending a guy named Moncton who's charged with murdering a bodyguard of Nick Trask. One of Trask's foot soldiers ends up shooting Jen in the back. She lives and she's greatly wounded. Luckily, Banner and Jen have the same blood type, so he was able to do an emergency transfusion. And he calls Fire Rescue, who transported her to the hospital while he's taken in for questioning, but quickly escapes, of course. The crooks come into the hospital disguised as physicians and they try to kill her. And this sparks her first transformation to Hulk form, and it happens rather violently. Those three crooks were thrown against the wall. Her skin, it's green, and it's like she's some kind of She-Hulk, they exclaim. And so she said, "You call me She-Hulk, then a She-Hulk I'll be." And so she dons the moniker as her own. But everything quickly goes downhill from Jen. She's chasing the crooks again and turns into this She-Hulk, and she's framed for the murders. She's holding this body in her hands and they capture it for the news. So she goes into hiding, and everyone, her dad included, thinks she also killed Jen. This She-Hulk killed Jen. She-Hulk is a murderer. When she sees that on the news, her pulse starts to race and she's ashamed and frightened and takes a handful of tranquilizers to stop the transformation. It works, but while she's She-Hulk, she can handle that dosage. Her human form of Jen cannot. Luckily, her friend Zapper is a medical student. He's able to revive her, but she nearly died. And this is when she meets her first fearsome foe. It's a mechanized She-Hulk, a prototype armor from Stark Industries that's a green metallic color complete with She-Hulk hair. But after they fall in the ocean and the green paint washes away, reveal an orange color. The green was meant to set up She-Hulk. As a Hulk derivative, the transfusion gives her a milder form of gamma radiation. She's able to think a bit more rationally in her Hulk form and retain some control over her actions and emotions. And this series lasted for 2 years and 25 issues. It was picked up again in 89 for a Sensational She-Hulk comic book that lasted from 94 and 60 issues. The second title was from her 1985 graphic novel of the same name, also by John Byrne, and the legacy numbering picked back up in 2018 with issue 159. There was a series in 2004, 2005, 2009. It was a mini with Dark Reign, and then a 4-issue She-Hulk's miniseries, and a 12-issue series in 2014 with an adjectiveless title, simply She-Hulk. But skipping ahead a little bit, but going back in time, She-Hulk helped fight in the Contest of Champions. In Avengers 221, she became a member of the Avengers, and for a time, her anger-fueled transformations were not controlled well. It was an outward expression of her subconscious. But after she defended Dr. Michael Morbius at a trial for his indictment for the Empiric Killings, he helped her control herself better. So she then decided to stay as She-Hulk permanently, shortly before being sent to Battleworld for the Secret Wars. When she got back with Fantastic Four, issue 265, She-Hulk became a member of the Fantastic Four, and she battled characters like Dr. Bong and Nick St. Christopher had some rather unusual tales. They were fun and quirky. She was that beautiful jade bombshell that made jokes and talked to her audience and fought foes all through the series. It's a lot of fun. She also dated Luke Cage for a while at the time when she was working for Heroes for Hire. And during that crazy time, during John Byrne's sensational She-Hulk run, is when we first see Jen Walter's fourth wall breaking. What that means is that she knows she's in a comic book, and I hope that is something of anything of hers. That's the one thing that I really want to see translated to her Disney Plus series. I think that'll be a lot of fun. And something different. In 2006, Marvel's 616 universe was embroiled in civil war. Jen registered with the Superhero Registration Act, siding with Tony Stark. As a woman of law, you know, it makes sense. She defended Speedball, his actions being what actually sparked the civil war in the first place, and she also had to press charges against Peter Parker. After registering, Jen was drafted in the service with S.H.I.E.L.D., but Stark had her injected with superpower-inhibiting nanobots, SpinTech, as a means of controlling her. But it was Amadeus Cho, totally awesome Hulk, now known as Braun, had to deactivate the nanobots so she could help fight the Hulk when he returned from World War Hulk. Shortly after this, Jen was brought before the Living Tribunal and that cosmic entity's Magistrati. She had to weigh herself against Earth 1610, the ultimate Marvel version of herself. She won her case, of course. She's a great lawyer. Just prior to Secret Invasion, Stark had recruited her for a short-lived Defenders team, and it's also shortly after this that she meets an irradiated Betty Ross, a Red She-Hulk, the same color as Thunderbolt Ross and his Red Hulk. But it appears in this story that Red She-Hulk snapped Jen's neck and killed her. She is alive, and she goes out with Korg, Scar, and his crew to space, and when they come back to Earth, have to travel to Hell itself to defeat the Chaos King and end the Chaos War. She later teamed up with Nighthawk, Howard the Duck, and Frankenstein to take down Man-Thing. But then, once again, the universe ended and was reformed into Battleworld. Jen became the Baroness of Arcadia and led its all-female defense force called A-Force. It's a team that these various projects are rumored to be leaning towards. Marvel's formula, it seems, is to drive their solo film and TV properties towards ensemble team ventures. Look at the Netflix shows, like an Avengers, could be A-Force or Young Avengers. There's tons of possibilities there. Anyway, A-Force stayed together with a relaunched book after Secret Wars, and Jen was part of that team that went after Thanos. This inhuman named Ulysses was actually able to see the future, so they could get a jump on Thanos, but in A-Force number 8, when Thanos assaulted a Project Pegasus facility, War Machine was killed, comes back eventually, and She-Hulk critically injured, but by the time she regained consciousness, the second Civil War had erupted. Hawkeye had shot her cousin, and so she decided to remain un-She-Hulked out and just focused on her lawyering. But think about it, she almost died at the hands of Thanos, and she wakes up and learns her cousin was shot with an arrow. Add to that the stress of litigious workload, and it resulted in her transforming again, but to a gray Hulk form. And this happened at the start of 2019 with the launch of a brand new Hulk volume. She eventually went back to her green Hulk form, but shortly thereafter would be greatly powered up at the hands of Esan the Searcher, a Celestial that actually asked her for help. She crossed paths with a new Avengers team and became infatuated with Thor. We see her as part of the Avengers team that her greatly powered up, less fun, and more savage self takes down an entire army of trolls and King Ulick with Captain Marvel during the War of the Realms. And then shortly thereafter, we see Jen in the Captain Marvel story fighting alongside Captain Marvel. So with casting announcements and potential plot points on the horizon, we have to wonder how closely will they stick to her origin story. The distribution rights for Hulk lay with Universal, and it's why we don't have a solo Hulk series on screen. It's why his story is told through Avengers and through Thor Ragnarok. So it may be just like Marvel and Sony with Spider-Man. These contracts are strict to cinema. TV and streaming rights, however, are a go. Plus, distribution is not a concern when you're talking about, you know, a streaming platform. If she's a defense attorney for superheroes, though, then it's not a solo property anymore, is it? They'll have plenty of people come in, and if they lean into her savage side a bit, could Mark Ruffalo's Bruce Banner show up and be to Jen what Tony is to Peter Parker? Also, she has plenty of characters from her backstory already introed in the MCU, from Abomination to the Leader to General Ross. They're just all there, ripe for the picking. So while this is new to us, the idea to bring She-Hulk to the screen is actually not a new one. Not something that Marvel conjured up in this current SJW culture, no. She was rumored to be set for an appearance next to Ferrigno's David Banner on the Hulk show that sparked Stan Lee to jump the gun on the network and get their own character in the comic books to retain that IP, which sparked her creation and which would have launched her own spin-off series. There was a Larry Cohen-directed film was planned in the 90s, and Red Sonja actress Brigitte Nielsen was even cast for the role. Eva Mendes was attached to the role in the mid-2000s for another film, and now finally she'll go up on Marvel's own streaming platform. So the next She-Hulk announcement we'll get will most likely be casting. And here's where you sound off. I want to know who do you think would be good to play She-Hulk? Let me know in the comments section below. Anyways, that's it, my friends, for this one. This is the origin and the history of Marvel's She-Hulk. As always, I welcome your comments, questions, corrections, and suggestions down in the comments section below. Don't forget to subscribe if you haven't already done so. Share this with your friends, too. I'm Jesse. This is JLS Comics, and I'll see you soon.